Hello? Can you hear me?
It's cool, it's cool.
Yeah. A very, very good evening. The stars, you know, watching over us. And a very warm welcome to, can I say it in French first? Une soirée, we say. The soirée of words and rhythms. This has been jointly curated by the Embassy of the Republic of Serbia and Poetry Across Cultures. And we have to begin with a word of gratitude to His Excellency for his support and encouragement, and to Mr. Dushan, he's the Deputy Chief of Mission, who's been constantly in touch and his efforts. Otherwise, you know, we couldn't have seen fruition to our dream today. So it's because of them. And we are delighted to have two literary luminaries with us, Dr. H.K. Kaul and Ambassador Dr. Amarendra Khatwa, both stalwarts in Indian English poetry. And they will be introduced to you soon during the course of the evening. Poetry Across Cultures, since its inception in the year 2007, has been promoting appreciation of poetry and global bonding across cultures, across geographical boundaries, across traditions, across languages. And in fact, these literary meets through this intellectual art form has navigated itself through the poetries of Finland, Romania, Russia, Japan, the United States, American poetry, France, we've had Hungary, Portugal, and in fact, Lithuania also. And Serbia happened exactly 10 years back, Your Excellency, in the year 2008, right here, but that time we had it indoors, and this is perhaps going to be a unique experience for us, because it's the first time we are having an outdoor reading. So with that, I have to say, without wasting any more time, and Dr. Khatwa has already warned me against long speeches, so I'll just say, let us deepen the, you know, relationship, the meditative relationship between words and the melody of music, between the poetic treasures of two rich cultures, India and Serbia. But before that, I would request His Excellency, Ambassador Vladimir Maric, to say a few words of welcome to our August gathering.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, good evening. As Dr. Malhotra said, I would like to welcome you to the Serbian Embassy here in Chanakyapuri. As you can see, we have, I believe, a beautiful compound, beautiful property here in the prime location in New Delhi. The reason for this is the fact that erstwhile leaders of Yugoslavia, former Yugoslavia, and India were very close. We established the non-aligned movement together, and because of the friendship between Prime Minister Nehru and President Tito of Yugoslavia, we have this beautiful embassy here that today we still use as Yugoslavia, the successor state of Serbia, the successor state of Yugoslavia. Dr. Malhotra said that this was a joint project, our embassy and her. I have to tell you that 99% of the work is hers, so I really congratulate and thank her for that. Her dynamism and energy is really something we all should appreciate. I would also like to greet our guests, Dr. Kaul and my old friend, Ambassador Khatwa. All of you as well. I hope, as Dr. Malhotra said, this will be the first reading outside. I hope that it won't be the first reading in the rain. water. So I'm just thinking that if it starts raining, you'll have to move on the terrace and maybe stand up, just as an emergency measure. Hopefully, you won't have to do that. So without much ado, I welcome you one more time, and I let you enjoy the beautiful program.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. And now I would like to pass on the proceedings to Divya hasn't arrived yet. She's here. Divya and Apranta. Miss Apranta is an alumna of Kamala Nehru College. She's a psychologist by profession and, of course, a poet too. And Divya is majoring in psychology from Gargi College, University of Delhi. And soon she's going to take over as president of the students' She's the youngest member. They are real young assets of Poetry of Thought.
I'm Rainbow Khatwa, the former Director General of ICCR, and he has also served as Ambassador of India to Argentina, Uruguay and Paraguay, Ivory Coast and Guinea and Liberia, and as High Commissioner to Sierra Leone in his illustrious diplomatic career. Dr. Vibhuti Vashish will now extend a formal welcome to sir. Welcome sir, we are honored to have you with us today. The Director Delmit and President of the Poetry Society of India. He is internationally known as an expert in library networking and a specialist in information sciences. He has been the chairman of several committees of various ministries in the government. He has authored and edited. Our gratitude to His Excellency Ambassador Maruj for his gracious hospitality and support throughout. Thank you so much, sir. Ms. Shivangi Sandhu is with you. Privileged to present our gratitude and regard to Mrs. Maruj, Deputy Chief of Mission and Embassy of the Republic of Serbia for his aid. Thank you so much, sir. We would be remiss if we didn't express our heartfelt gratitude and regard during the honors.
Thank you.
And then yes,
and
check.
And now?
Thank you.
pleasure to invite Dr. H.K. Kaul to lead the readings of the evening.
Mr. Vladimir Marek, Madam Marek, Dr. Amarendra Katwa, Mr. Joosan, Dr. Rita Malhotra, distinguished poets, friends who have come here. I would like to, first of all, congratulate Dr. Rita Malhotra, who initiated this program of poetry across the cultures. I must have organized a lot of programs at the India International Center during the last 35 years and hosted a lot of poets from various continents. And they have had wonderful ideas to share. And when you look at the universe of consciousness, the poets work on a different layer of consciousness, and they have a lot to share, and they have a lot to work for the societies wherever they are. In 1979, we had been organizing an affirmation workshop for writers, and we had decided that we will establish a bureau of affirmation authors and poets, but somehow that didn't get established at that time. But I feel that there's a need to translate poetry from across cultures and understand the feelings of poets who touch upon some of the basic issues the societies are going through. One of the ideas which probably Dr. Rita Malhotra may work on is the idea of the meaning of images across cultures used in poetry. An image used in poetry may have a different meaning in some language and a country and a culture, and different meaning in some language and another culture. So there's a need to really understand the meaning of these images and the context in which they have been used. We feel that there's much to work together around the globe, and poets can play a great role. I again feel that this is a wonderful setting today. It's neither dark, it's neither fully lit, it's neither fully raining, and it's neither very hot, it's neither very humid. It's wonderful. I would like to thank the stars and His Excellency for a wonderful setting that we have this evening here today. I would like to read, I have been asked to read two of my poems, and the themes are wonderful, but I would like to read two poems which probably maybe liked here. Right, we have the Lord Shiva's temple on top of it. So I'm reading a poem there about it. It's titled On the Slopes. Here on the slopes of Shankaracharya, I faced Dull Lake at the dusk of an era. Sitting on a slippery stone, I tried to balance between the time lost and the dark night ahead. My brothers and sisters living in the houses, houseboats, spread unknowingly ghostly shadows through unseasoned window panes and recently made slits in the old doors. These shadows settle on the spaces between the frozen willow trees or the trembling waters of the lake. I have no home in this ancestral valley. It was captured in absentia. No house to spend the dark night ahead, which lies ahead in this town of ghosts. I am a wanderer, now rolling along. I have no gun, no bombs, not even a sword to strengthen me. I have just a pen, which is stuck to my head and heart. I try to scribble on the stone my love for everything around. It refuses to absorb my ink. What do I need to do to mark my presence, to melt the stone and not break it? Another poem I'm reading is called Milestones. The tides of change washed away all my old milestones. I counted a few and remembered them. Reinventing the wheel now again against the backdrop of compromises was to chunk all that marched up and down the corridors of my past, holding only the message of labor and love. Living those moments without wiping away tears of friends or noticing those of poor spines, weaker minds, raise new roadblocks within. Pressing selfless forces out of the poor, clinging to steep hillsides, brought a whole new sensitivity of life and death, of man behind man, teaching me milestones merge into timeless spaces. The tides of transformation never die. Never wait for anyone, but bring debris of milestones down to the sea, creating grounds for newer ones. In the journey, in the sea, or on the shores that are lashed all the time by the waves of wisdom, it takes millions of years for the rocks to smoothen or merge into water that lash them up. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Paul, for these beautiful poems. Today is the part of the... Today is the part of an ongoing celebration of the Serbian. To give a brief introduction on Serbian poetry. Ma'am is former principal, Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. She is currently the founder president, Poetry Across Cultures, India, and plays many roles, a mathematician, a poet, essayist, poetry critique, and translator. She is the recipient of several national and international recognitions for poetry, culture, and education, including the Distinguished Visionary Poet Awards by Writers International Network Canada and the Award for Outstanding Merit in Promoting Romanian and Universal Values in International Relations by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Romania.
Thank you, Divya. Different, cultures and nations. So I took it out. This is a small paragraph from my latest book on poetics. And I'm so happy to see Mr. Sanjay, who's been my publisher, because I always say publishers who publish poetry are the most courageous ones. So thank you, Sanjay, for this. As far as Serbian poetry is concerned, fundamental Serbian poetry is the Serbian epic poetry. And as far as epic poetry goes, in Serbia, they are considered to be of a very superior order. It's called heroic poetry, and they are mainly concerned with historical figures, historical events, and they are in anime. And the Battle of Kosovo cycle, many of us would have heard of this battle. For the Serbs, for the Serbian people, if I'm not mistaken, is the central event of the Serbian history and a very important event. Now for us Indians, any mention of epic poetry or folklore, we can easily connect with our Sanskrit ancient scriptures, the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, and of course they are the canons of Hindu scriptures. And also, our epic poetry, they are also a pristine reflection of myth and tradition. So here goes the connect. As far as folklore is concerned, all of us are very familiar, whether it's a community festival or it is any, ritualistic event. I think folk poetry and folk songs are always rendered in these events, so they are nothing new to us. And I'll just add a line from the mid-80s. The dominant poetic model in Serbia was one that returns to traditional forms and important universal themes. The most critical, socially engaged poetry has been written by women. So I had to read this line, and therefore that's very encouraging. And if I talk of Serbian poetry, I cannot not mention Vasco Popa, the national poet of Serbia. He is, I would say, a poet of titanic stature, and he has been, of course, widely translated, critically acclaimed, not only in Serbia, but, you know, around the world. And the best part of Popa's...
In Indian languages also,
like Dr. Katwad. And Popa's poetry, you know, it is not characteristic of old lyric poetry, talking about personal feelings and emotions. It's always about man's world surrounding him. And we also say, what is poetry? It's a poet's passionate dialogue with the world around him, with his associations, you know, with his immediate surroundings. And Popa's poetry is very metaphorical. I can guarantee each one of us reads the same poem of Popa, and each one will come out with a new poem, because for every reader it becomes a new poem. It's so metaphoric. Here, if I don't mention an eminent Indian poet, it would be heresy. I have to mention him. I have always considered him my mentor. It is the late eminent poet Rakshat Puri. Why I am reminded of Rakshat Puri when I read Popa is because his poems not only do they have artistic integrity, and of course he was known for his modern poetic consciousness, but his poems are metaphorically so rich that, you know, they have layers and layers of meaning, and that is perhaps what true poetry, at least I can never attain that level. So I remembered him. We don't have time to read a poem by Rakshati, but because we're doing Serbian and Indian poetry, I had to bring out this connect. And I would have to read a small, very small poem by Popa. You know, he has written about 11 poems in a series called The Little Box. It is The Little Box, The Tenants of the Little Box, The Last News About the Little Box. And I'll just take the first one, and you can all interpret it later. I'll also add a line saying what I think about it, because it is also part of my essay on Vasco Popa. So here goes the first in the series, The Little Box. He says, "The little box gets her first teeth, and her little length, little width, little emptiness, and all the rest she has. The little box continues growing. The cupboard that she was inside is now inside her. And she grows bigger and bigger and bigger. Now the room is inside her. And the house, the city, and the earth, and the world she was in before is inside her. Now in the little box, you have the whole world in miniature. You can easily put it in a pocket, easily steal it, easily lose it. Take care of the little box." It's such a beautiful poem, and you know, I interpreted it in my essay on Vasco Popa as a girl child who grows up, you know, essays all kinds of roles, goes through her struggles, absorbs worldly wisdom, assimilates all that in her, and finally she becomes a little child again, you know, and so we must take care of the little box. Thank you so much. And now we have a surprise, which was a surprise for me this morning. The First Lady of the Embassy of Republic of Serbia has consented to read a poem in Serbian. It's a poem of her choice, and I said, why not add the flavor of Serbia here? After all, it's Indian Serbia, ma'am.
Thank you for this introduction. I want to welcome you all here tonight, and I hope the rain didn't bother you that much. In Serbia, poetry reading is considered to be a very romantic thing, so I think this rain brings even more romance to this evening. So the poem I'll read to you is called Gutum. It's an ode written by Serbian poet Milutin Vojić during the First World War. It is dedicated to the soldiers who died, who were buried in the sea near Vido Island in Greece. In this poem, Vojić expressed the tragic fate of Serbian people whose army has passed from Montenegro and Albania to the Greece peak islands of Corfu and Vido, where 5,400 young Serbian soldiers were buried in the sea. And out of respect to those who died, Greek fishermen didn't want to fish in these waters for 50 years. The poem is in Serbian, but I hope I'll bring out the emotion which carries with it. Stojite, galije carske, sputajte krme moćne, gazite tihim hodom. Opelo gordo držim u doba jeze noćne nad ovom svetom vodom. Tu na dnu, gde školjke san umoran hvata i na mrtve alge tresetnica pada. Leži groblje hrabri, leži brado brata, Prometeji nade, apostoli jada. Zar ne osjećate kako more mili da ne ruši večni pokoj palih četa? Iz dubokog jaza mirni dremeš čili, a umornim letom zrak meseca šeta. To je hram tajanstva i grobnica tužna za ogromnog mrca ko naš um beskrena, tiha kao ponoć vrh ostrvlja južna. Mračna kao savjet, hladna i očinu. Zar ne osjećate iz modrih dubina da pobožnost raste vrh voda prosuta i vazduhom igra čudna pantomima, to velika duša pokojnika luta. Stojite, galije carske, na grobu braće moje, zavite crnim trube, stražari u svečanom opelu, nek otpoje tu gde se vali ljube. Jer proći će mnoga stoleća kopena što prolazi morem i umre brez znaka i doći će nova i velika smena da dom sjaja stvara na gomili raka. Ali ovo groblje gde je pogrebena ogromna i strašna tajna epopeje, kolica će biti bajke za vremena gde će duda traži svoje koripeje. Sahranjeni tu su nekadašnji venci i prolazna radost cijelog jednog roda, zato grob taj leži u talas senci između nedra zemlje i nebesnog svoda. Stojite, galije carske, buktinje nek utrnu, veslanje umre hujno, a kad opelo svršim, klizite u noć crnu, pobožno i nečujno. Jer hoću da vlada beskrajna tišina i da mrtvi čuju huk borbene lave kako vrućim ključem krv penuša njina u deci što kliću pod okriljem slav. Jer tamo daleko poprište se zari ovom istom krvju što ovde počiva, ovde iznad oca pokoj gospodari, tamo iznad sina povesnica biva. Zato hoću mira da opela služim bez reči, bez suza i uzaha mekih, da mir istamljena i dah praka združim u stutnjavu muku togoša daleki. Stojite, galije carske, u ime svesne pošte, klizite tihim hodom, opelu držim kako ne vide nebo još nad ovom svetom vodom. These are the tears because of the emotion, not because I was nervous before reading the poem.
Themes for the evening. And we begin our readings now with the first theme, which is questions of faith. And the amazing part of this theme is we received poems from our Indian poets and we had already chosen some Serbian poems. And can you imagine the connect? You know, one concept runs through all the poems, almost all the poems, that is the concept of existence of God. So it just feels as if all the poems have been woven from the same fabric. And that was amazing about this. So we begin our reading. And the last poem in this section is a little different in the sense it gives a different perspective of faith, but that is also so wonderful. It, you know, seems to be saying, like James Lawrence, never give up the ship.
Thank you so much, Malhotra, an old friend of mine. We've been fellow travelers in not only writing poetry, but also to be hosting and organizing a couple of programs which we've been doing recently. I've learned a lot from Rita because she started Poetry Across Cultures about a decade back, and it's been one poetry evening in one embassy or high commission or the other almost on an average every year, which not only exposes us to poetries and cultures of different regions, different languages, different continents and different countries, but the way the programs have been formulated, you know, it also gives us an idea about the kind of emotional connect which she was talking about on similar themes. Different poems have been picked up on similar themes from issues and, ideas where we see the connect with Indian poets on those themes. So therefore, the format of the programs have been planned entirely by Dr. Malhotra. It was a wonderful idea, and it's been 10 years now, so let's congratulate her for completing more than a decade of poetry across cultures. Today is one such evening where we are celebrating Serbian poetry, and of course some of us have been invited to read our own on similar themes. I also congratulate the ambassador here for hosting this evening in this lovely venue. It's springtime, poetry is in the air, and what could be better than hosting an evening like this where we read poems from two countries on like-minded themes. The first theme is on questions of faith.
Yes.
I picked up a recently written poem of mine. Am I audible at the back?
Yes.
Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah.
Let me read.
Dr. Vishaka Das, I'm next. If you could possibly come and sit here, we'll make some space for you. With Amrit, could we get some chips?
Epiphany might be a revelation, but again, what is the subject here is again about God, his existence or not, and that's our perennial dilemma. So I leave it to each one of us to judge what we think about that, but only God can come and answer this. I read. A poor wretch, I wake up. My head spins from grief and think. What if, God forbid, God appears? Simply drops in, so no more. Does he or doesn't he exist? Where is he? Did you see him? Comes for all to witness. If he exists, there is no choice. He must come down and introduce himself. I'm so and so, if you'd like to know. The devil speaks to me, and right away doubts grow like nettles. An evil thundering board makes me withdraw the thought that he would come, even though he doesn't exist. But if he comes, we can't say he didn't. I would like it better if he didn't exist, but came. Then, if he existed, but never came, may I not live a minute longer just to see his coming? My life would be fulfilled. I don't believe he would come because of me to hope in heaven and start down on such a road. Even without him, I know what would happen as clearly as if my own eyes saw it, and God, like God, would watch in silence. Thank you.
Hello. Is it true? Good evening, Your Excellency, the First Lady, the lovers of quotes and rhythms. Well, I am a rough man of hard prose, but it so happened that once Dr. Rita Malhotra met me and she called me for this, reciting this. Now, if my recitation is bad, which it sure is going to be, please blame Dr. Rita and not me. Anyway, argument is two. At that spot, as the gravitation of the earth was not an abstraction, because it dropped like a pulse, so vigorously that you thought it was all which remained from your old age masculine power, and that God abandoned you when you began to roar. Only then did it become obvious to you that Socrates was not wrong, saying that all his life he had been prepared only for defense, and that it seemed to him even God wished his life to be over. Who knows what else the gods want when resins burn in your mirrors, the dearest sketches are disarmed, smoke gushes. And once, the moment you went a bit mad, you thought it was enough to move the earth. Perhaps those fragments of folly should be taken again, clean from cobweb and dust, and seen how easily starry nights got lost due to the ideas which at one eye time, from one season to another, first gain in weight and then become poles. Has this sand flowed out and the time come? I don't know. But I do know the road to Syracuse is no longer wise, as nobody's return to fatherland is either. Thank you. Hadranka Velikovic. I hope my pronunciation is correct. Thank you once again.
teaches her her lesser known languages. She will be reading her own poem, Black and White.
Good evening all. I'm grateful to the Embassy of the Republic of Serbia and Poetry Across Cultures to make me a part of this evening. It's black and white. It is the wiggle, and it's black and white. While I sit back and ponder on the vicissitudes of scenes and sights, the hazardous terrain, the twine train, the misty wilderness, and the undulating plain, I remain steadfast as I set my goal. I often tumble, feel withered, albeit never fail to rewind and recast. Each labored bent, ages I fight, sundry hurdles I surmount day and night. The malady does not demean my might. I fed on, amidst the wiggle, a streak of sunlight. The vacillation I confront, every newfound stride, imparts caution paved in white, the black veiled sun mock, pleasure and delight. It is quiver and shake of veracity and fake, of the times wrecked and wry, dimmed and divine. May the light within always shines. Happy faces seem benign. Pains strain my mind. Saccharine sermons sound refined. Bitter etch took it precise. The beautiful airs entice. For the dreadful, I heave a sigh. I do recognize the essence that inhabits the black and the white. Thank you.
We pass on to our next theme, Hues of Love. Vishal, I hope you're ready. So now we are stepping into the universe of love. It is an emotion which I would say is an emblem of a timeless world, and it all the time seeps into the poet's consciousness, perhaps one of the truest perceptions of the human mind. So Purane ki Wajah. Vishal Bhattacharya is majoring in history in Delhi College of Arts and Commerce, University of Delhi. And he is also training in Indian classical vocal music at Gandharva Mahavidyalaya. Krishna.
The first song that I am singing right now is Muskurane Ki Wajah. I have chosen this song because I love the meaning that it has in it. So. मुस्कुराने की वजह तुम हो गुनगुनाने की वजह तुम हो जिया जाए ना जाए ना जाए ना और पिया रे जिया जाए ना जाए ना जाए धूप आए तो
chaudhulana Khwaisho ki barisho me Bheeg sang jana Dhoop aaye to Chao tum lana Khwaisho ki barisho me Bheeg sang jana Jiya jai na jai na jai na Ur piya re Jiya jai na jai na jai na Ur piya re Piya re Jo mile usme Kaat lenge hum Thodi khushiya थोड़े आंसू बांट लेंगे हम जो मिले उसमें काट लेंगे हम थोड़ी खुशियां थोड़े आंसू बांट लेंगे हम जिया जाए ना जाए ना जाए ना और प्यारे मुस्कुराने की वजह तुम हो गुनगुनाने की वजह तुम हो जिया जाए ना जाए ना जाए ना और प्यारे जिया जाए ना जाए ना जाए ना और प्यारे प्यारे
थैंक यू
इट इज आवर प्लेजर टू इनवाइट एंबेसडर डॉक्टर अमरेंद्र खतवा टू इनिशिएट विद द रीडिंग्स फॉर दिस थीम
अनएडिटेड लास्ट वन Give me your love. Love is like pre-recuperative oxygen. Its need undocumented. But do not ever permit me to preach substance in return. I flourish in what you give, but I stray in a world of self-doubt, often populated by an unimaginative itch. I can be any man, yet I'm no one's man. Your touch fits my heart. Your body unhinges all my nebulous waitings, and you open up all my unseen force of angst into becoming a shape of your translucent love. Can you retain me like this? Do not unfetter all my animal wounds, my hungry untamed shadows. They always take me away from your love and from myself. Then when the emptiness of roaring melancholia paws my chest and mauls my eyelids, I fail to recognize you, and I'm irretrievably lost. Just inches outside your love, away from the perfection of your being there. The second one, ask me a simple question. I will seek the sparkles in your eyes and lose all my humming words. Our love is like that. We catch moments in our beckoning, and build gossamer dreams. The tune flutters in our togetherness. I borrow pure pleasure from your unreachable desirability. You give my petrified hunger a season of filtered beauty. My love candle drops your recognition. I breathe and belong. I cannot imagine hunting a day without your donating tender echoes, practicing possession inside my heart. You are and I exist. Fulfilled on the collage of your lips, size, body and desire. I will answer one day, under the applique colors of our enchantment, I will dedicate a painting, heart shape.
Anatomy to pain as well. Pain also must have an anatomy as a vice versa. By many a midnight taper, I have not known how to put it on paper. By many a midnight taper, I have not known how to put it on paper. Journeys to faraway lands where I scribble lost love on fickle sea sands. Hopes that some grave will create a magic word file where I can save. The labyrinth of building love day by day and word by word, only to know it's a flying dove. Rituals of blood and gore in some remote mountain, as if the body were a door that welcomed and rejected randomly some people in pain before it ejected itself into a hollow and beckoned, follow, follow, follow. Those nights of wine when we professed all taints are divine. Time marches in an hourglass, claustrophobic contains things like God has to put up with mass. How by midnight taper could you really put all that in paper? How do they do it, dissect pain like a frog, including its shit, bit by bit? Thank you.
An assistant professor, Department of Philosophy, Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. She will be reading two poems, Calendar of Dreams by Dragan Javorovich and My Heart by Milutin Petrovic.
Good evening. It's A Calendar of Dreams by Dragan Javorovich. Repeat to yourself what the winds remember and record it in a calendar of dreams. Their mornings are longer than a year. Their love recalls everything that could have happened. Here, their dreams cannot wait. Their dreams cannot wait. The next poem that I'm reading is My Heart by Milutin Petrovic. You have dropped from the chains. The chains are in a cloud. Your nature is on the wall, thick as is well known. Leading who knows where. You haven't had enough of the world, and not in a book, but in a cry of love. You keep returning to me. My heart, someone is knocking. My heart, someone is knocking. Thank you.
Reading is Solitude by Dragan Javorovic. Snow all afternoon. Snow all afternoon. Everything is snowbound. Just smoke rising above houses. Yet for you, the door was left open long ago. For you, the door was left open long ago. A snowstorm and the night are thrusting in. Lamps sit on the windowsills. You are not there. Not there on the doorstep. The next poem that I'm reading is Invoking Summer by Dragan Dragojevic. The river rose and receded. The river rose and receded. Autumn pushes through little rapids. Its hair sways. Its hair sways between willows and its call spreads. Spreads through the field to reach the place where there used to be sand. Where you would abandon your body to dreams and to the sun. Where you would abandon your body to dreams and to the sun. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ravindra Malhotra is an entrepreneur, musician and poet. He'll be reading his own poem, Ode to My Love.
Thank you, Dr. Rita Malhotra, and Excellency the Ambassador of Serbia, and our guest poet. The poem I am to read is titled as Ode to My Love. The moon delights to feel your hand, the clouds to kiss your face. The moon delights to feel your hand, the clouds to kiss your face. Your eyebrows seize the rainbows, enjoys it and embrace. The mist delights to feel your arms, the dew to moist your lips, Your eyes behold a splendor unmatched in eclipse. The rain delights to feel your moods, the rivers to quench your thirst. Your breath warms the winter nights to let a new dawn burst. The birds delight to sing to you. The birds delight to sing to you. The bees to hum a tune. Your heart flutters in unison with the gentle winds of June. The earth delights to feel your feet. The wind to play your hair. Your smile lights the morning sun. I see you everywhere. Thank you.
Filmmaker and affectionate mother, she'll be reading Warning by Disanka Maximovic.
Good evening all, and thank you Rita ma'am for calling me today and giving me such a wonderful experience. This is Warning by Disanka Maximovic. Listen, I'll tell you my secret. Never leave me alone when music plays. It could seem to me that some eyes gray are so deep and soft, the eyes that are actually plain. It could seem to me that I dive into the sound and I could give my hands to anyone around. It could seem to me so easy, so gay, to love someone for only one day. Or I could tell someone my dearest magically growing secret, how much I love you. Oh, never leave me alone when music plays. It could seem to me that again, somewhere in a forest, my tears flow through a new well. It could seem to me that a black butterfly makes pattern on heavy water, those that no one feels free to tell. It could seem to me that somewhere in the dark zone, someone sings and touches my heart with a bitter flower. Right there, the incurable wound stays. Oh, never leave me alone, never alone, when music plays. Thank you.
We all know that the fertile void of the dark underground is where the seeds germinate. In the same way, some of our poets have ignited their creativity in the dark of life, in the dark of mind. Again, it is amazing to see how through the Serbian and Indian poems, the concept of death is prevalent. So we begin with the dark of life.
A decorated veteran of the Indian Army and a widely published poet, he'd be reading his own poem, The Dark is Neither Wrong Nor Right.
Good evening, Your Excellency, First Lady, Rita ma'am, and distinguished guests. It's apt that the dark theme comes after love. Love develops in the dark. The dark is neither wrong nor right. Proclaim the night was neither wrong or right. I have been the one acquainted with the night. Robert Frost. Now this is my poem. The jury is still out, my friend. Daniel cannot come to judgment. He snores. Let Daniel sleep. Let Daniel sleep. Meanwhile, come, let us converse with the dark of the night. The dark, my friend, is neither wrong nor right. It lets the stars sing on. At dusk, it was I who hung the sun out to dry. It singed until it burned itself out. For now, let us not judge. Let us not search for a plausible reason why the moon is ambivalent. Perhaps it is not the catalyst or the accomplice of our nocturnal mishaps. Maybe this fickle-mindedness stems from within us. Daniel stores twilight tiptoes to dawn. Case adjourned. Thank you.
We call upon Ms. Kavita Singer, who is a poet, social worker and educationist. She will be reading The Last Day by Nevoya Vasovich.
Good evening, everyone.
I wish to thank the Serbian Embassy and Dr. Rita Malhotra for having me here today to share this beautiful evening. It's a beautiful night in spring, and I read this dark poem called The Last Day by Nebojša Vasović. It's translated by the poet himself. The last day. Today is Friday, the last day of my life. I decided to die today, not tomorrow. And I decided to die here, not somewhere else, on my balcony, overlooking the garden. I have already drunk my last coffee. Now I give way to memories. The eyes of my friends are dominoes in the fog. The gutters of a woman I loved are rotten autumn leaves. Words that I exchanged with others, petty sounds like those of Australian finches. I don't know what my biggest mistake was. I think I should have spent more time swimming, listening to music, walking, doing nothing, going nowhere, waiting for no one, not trusting anyone, loving myself. That's the most difficult. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Our next poet is Mr. Soumitra Sen. He's a passionate photographer, a student of Hungarian language, and is a superannuated officer of Air India. He'll be reading two poems, The Best Way by Milovan Danilic and Scars by Miroslav Maximovic.
First of all, a very good evening to everyone in this August gathering. I have been asked to read out two very grim-sounding poems, specially chosen by Dr. Rita Malhotra, maybe because of the grimness of my countenance. Here goes. First of all is The Best Way by Milovan Danilic. I hope it's right, or close to the being right. One can commit suicide with a gun, with a knife, with a tram wheel, mainly metal. Some use poison, some water and fire. There are those who jump from a high. Those are all roundabout ways. All the mentioned ways use 10 times more energy than required. You can see for yourselves, running towards a speedy train seems like ridiculous self-overestimation. I maintain that hanging is most appropriate, for the body weighs exactly as much as it needs to cope with itself. The second one, equally grim, is Scars by Miroslav Maximovic. After a traffic accident, scars have remained on my body. When I get suntan at the seaside, my skin does not peel in these spots. These are rare, unchangeable traces of life. Scars are eternal, as it were, when they do not hurt. Thank you.
Elsa Matthews is a senior journalist by profession. She is currently working at the United Nations High Commission for Refugees in the capacity of Senior Commission and Public Information Assistant. She will be reading her own poem, The Graveyard.
The Graveyard. She had learned to kill them on her own, slowly, gently, smoothly. As she plucked out the petals of her bridal roses, its thorns piercing into her skin. Singed with desire, she had been killing them for some time now. Quietly, stealthily, steadily. Gulping down the unshed tears, the salt embittering her virgin wound. Yes, she had been smothering them soundlessly before the whimperings reminded her of forbidden longings and buried them one by one, bloodlessly in her secret garden. On each grave red,
Here lies the fruit of the pure-hearted, the forsaken seed of unrequited love.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Before we proceed with the next poem, I request Dr. Tasneem Sehnaz to please move towards Madhumitana. The next poet is Vaidehi Rajendran. She is in her third year, majoring in psychology at Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. She will be reading Thank You, Death by Stephen Tontic.
Good evening, distinguished guests, First Lady, Your Excellency. This is a poem by Stefan Tontic, translated by Mary Raslovich. I hope I'm not the pronunciation.
Thank you, Death. You only give me strength to bear this outbreak of miracles in my life. Only you, little mother. My soul is firm, clear, and decisive. My muscles numb. If it weren't for you, my dear one, how would I know? Have managed up to now. As it is, I'm serene at least, calm at last, at one with myself before the face of God, enclosed in the spacesuit of my body, which is already pulling away. I, your son, Death. I, who have searched from the moment of birth for you, surrender to a dream of non-existence.
Thank you, Webby. Amita Rana is a doctoral candidate in the Department of Theatre and Performance at JNU. She is also an actor who has performed in over 20 plays and independent films. She'll be reading two poems, Song and Death by Stephen Reifowitz, and Dark Things by Novella Tadic.
Good evening, dear guests. Thank you, Dr. Rita Malhotra, for giving me this opportunity. Dark Things. Dark things open my eyes, raise my hands, not my fingers. They are close and far away, beyond nine hills, in a hidden refuge. Night is their kingdom, and this day, just breaking, is their cloak of light. No force can cancel them, untangle them, explain them. They stay where they are, in our chests, murmuring in their hearts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Dr. Tasneem Sehnaz is an associate professor of English, Aurobindo College, University of Delhi. She will be reading her own poem, The Soiled Soul.
A very good evening to all august and distinguished people here who have gathered today for this evening of words. And thank you, Rita and the Serbian Embassy, for offering this very delightful, soul-stirring experience. There was a thin sliver of moon, you know, at the background, which has since disappeared. And my poem speaks to the darkness around it. It's called The Soiled Soul. Perched on the edge of consciousness, hovering between shadow and substance, looking down the sheer precipice of the abysmal abyss of twilight darkness, specters of the past rise up, phantoms of the present float down, nebulous, shadowy, known, unknown, glimmerings of light waver and fuse, clouded by a thick sin screen. The awful, awesome scene clings like smoke from a smoker's mouth. Can we partake of better sights? Can we clean our soiled souls? Thank you.
postgraduate student of history at Jawaharlal Nehru University. She'll be reading two poems by Dragan Dragovic. The day will be over and news confirmed.
Good evening. I'll be reading two poems by Dragan Dragovic. The first one's called News Confirmed. The land, which was once our happy home, has been proclaimed to be the realm of war and chaos. The land, which was once our happy home, has been proclaimed to be the realm of war and chaos. And death, the master of oblivion, builds castles beneath the earth because there's nothing left above it. The day will be over. The day will be over, all the same, and so will the night. The mortars will strike tomorrow as they did today. We have grown accustomed to dying and being wounded. But what are we to do with so much grief? Thank you.
Our next theme of the evening is the poetic space that is there. And the poems that we write or read or even, recite, render, they are just an externalization of that infinite space within us. So we begin with the poet's inner world now.
Our first poet for this theme, reading her own poem, Reflection.
Good evening, everybody. And I was kind of inhaling the medley of fragrance all around and wondering, are we really sitting in a polluted Delhi? Because it didn't really seem so. It's a wonderful platform. Thank you so much for allowing me to be in the confluence of thoughts. The poem I'll be reading is called Reflection, which is again the poet's inner world, because it's a reflection, a tribute to my father, who was a healer, a professional doctor, but also a saint, a saintly erudite personality. So it's a tribute to all the fathers. Reflection. The bouquet stands bowed as always in front of the framed silver photograph, paying obeisance like a priest when he chants eyes closed, palms joined. The bouquet in a rainbow amalgam cautiously fans the frame of an ordinary man, a yogi, call him whatever you may, gentle, kind, saying it all with his ubiquitous smile. Misunderstood and dejected in life, he rejects none. He forgives everyone, encompassing all those who seek him out. A solitary pilgrim on his wondrous pilgrimage, with me beside, humbled and sad, a mirror image. The bouquet stands, bowed as always, in front of the framed silver photograph. Thank you.
That was beautiful, ma'am. We have Deepika Gulati, who is majoring in English at Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. She'll be reading Starry Houses by Dragan Dragovic.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Rita ma'am, the Serbian Embassy, Poetry Across Cultures, for giving me this incredible opportunity wherein I'm able to give voice to this poem, Starry Houses, by Dragan Dragovic. Apologies if there has been any error with the pronunciation. All night long, stars roll in the dust, and he makes houses out of them for orphans. Winds blow, foul rains fall on him, on his arms, his body. The starry houses are filled. Winds blow, foul rains fall on him, on his arms, his body. The starry houses are filled. From somewhere he hears his name. He can't see who's calling. It sounds like his son's voice. But he hasn't yet built a house for him. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deepika. Miss Sanjula Sharma is a senior journalist who has authored several books of poetry. She'll be reading her own poem, Autumn Leaves. I know it's a very beautiful spring night, and my poem is called Autumn Leaves, but you'll understand why, because it goes with the theme. That's why I believe it was chosen.
good evening to a very distinguished dais. Kudos to Dr. Rita Malhotra and Poetry Across Cultures for a wonderful innings played for a decade. Really want to congratulate you for all the wonderful evenings we've been a part of. Dear poets, many friends here, and a very patient audience, I am really delighted to be a part of this really wonderful gathering, which is full of ambience and romance and, of course, the beautiful smells and sights and sounds around us. My poem is called Autumn Leaves. Like autumn leaves, they fall one by one, softly upon the ground, the dust they came from. The earth they go to now, to rest and to retrieve their karma load, onto the road, to a heaven they did not know. It was old age, you say, the body had to give way, but I wondered that the spirit didn't. I still think of their laughter, the way they lived in bliss, as if nothing was amiss. More sanguine than you and me, oblivious of mortality. Those old souls that kept young, those old hearts that remain unsung, your father, my aunt, a grandmother, the forgotten ancestors on a family tree, the roots from which we branched out, and the oaks from which we swung, priceless inheritance on the ground. One day, like autumn leaves, we too will fall, one by one, upon the solid ground, the dust we came from. It's time to change color now. Green to red, to sunburnt gold. Agile body turning old, the spirit starting to fold its tired wings into the soul. Onto the road to a heaven we still cannot fathom.
Dr. Robert Mizo is Assistant Professor of Political Science, Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. He is also a member of Poetry Across Cultures. He will be reading After the Flood by Sasha Radiosuch.
Good evening, everyone. After the Flood by Sasha Radiosuch, translated by Meera and Matarich. After the Flood. Once again, the tiger swishing her tail levels the mountains. The great mother rolls on her side after the nations exit from her womb. The rain will fall and the sun will rise. Once again, merchants and sailors will tell their tales. You will not be here and I will turn into a doctor. New will be the names of all things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Jagmohan is a professor of mathematics, DAV College, University of Delhi. He's also a ghazal writer. He'll be reading Fragment, written by Ivan B. Lalik.
Thank you, Deva. Very good evening to all. And I would, at the very outset, like to thank Dr. Rita Malhotra. She has given me an opportunity second time to come to a program by Curated Across Cultures. Of course, first time it was not. I was not reading a poem, rather Gunjan Kumar Jha sang one of my ghazals and he told me he's going to sing one today as well. Anyways, so by the way, I'm from more connected with Hindi and Urdu poetry, so I may not have a very good pronunciation in English, but still I dare to read. This is a poem by Ivan V. Lalich, and of course it has been translated by Alison and Vladimir Papo. I'm pronouncing them right, and it is inspired by, partially inspired by Pindar, I think, a Greek poet. Pindar, yes. The poem is Fragment. Beauty that makes all mortals delight, truth we make of, but is false. Future alone is a trustee. Put forth, henceforth, only good of the gods. Truth is for them redundant, dubious, even dangerous. That's why I sing of that summer filled with vague gods, why I embellish it with metaphors and gild it with refined words. But the summer is unhealthy. But the summer is unhealthy, and the sea is unhealthy, and the air I am breathing. But and the air I breathe, the planetscape has holes. Yet I sing of beauty. Yet I sing of beauty from memory, or maybe in part, inertia, memory's twin system. Therefore, I sing of illusion in the lasting hope that future will one day prove that illusion was important. In a world too real to be true, in a world too beautiful to be real. Thank you. I think it would be appropriate if I get up without thanking Dr. Rita for and the team for selecting such beautiful things. I mean, it was an experience listening to all these things. Thank you very much. And she rightly said the emotions are connected across languages, poetry is connected across languages and across cultures. I think we'll get some time someday where on the same themes we read our own. Thank you.
I think the credit goes to Apranta, so we have an applause for Apranta. Vitamra, where are you? We all sat together and we selected them together. So thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Mom, for graciousness. Miss Aditi is a freelance writer and poetry lover. She'll be reading The Poems I Write by Radmila Lazic. Okay.
Yeah. I think this is okay. So good evening, everybody, and thank you very much. And I just love the poem which was chosen for me. Whoever chose it, and she did, Rita. Thank you. So this is called The Poems I Write by Radmila Lazic. I ought to have a new lover, get rid of the one I have, as if he were a can with a past due date. I ought to drive fast cars, my hair flying out of the window, as if I were some Rosamond riding on a horse. These are the poems I write. I ought to sleep till noon, spread myself over a great big bed, like wheat over sweet Mother Earth. I ought not to care about time, not to move slowly, not to hurry, to drink each day down to its dregs, night after night, like a chain smoker, and step on a butt with my heel. Words are embers. I burn myself into poetry. These are the poems I write. I ought to wear tight dresses, drape my shoulders with furs, wear high heels on my heels, paint myself and cover myself with jewels like a Christmas tree so my own mother doesn't recognize me. I ought to be cheerful, smiling, flirting, to sing and dance till 3 a.m., mindful of my sex appeal when some stud approaches me. These are the poems I write. Thorns, bumblebees and bees with their stingers ought not to touch me. These are the poems I write.
We come to the last. The day the Lord created hope was perhaps the day he created spring. Such beautiful words. In fact, hope works both on the conscious and the unconscious aspects of the being, you'll all agree. But as we step onto the path of hope, we shall leave all dark shadows behind. Again, with Vishal, rendering Aao Ke Jab Tum. I think Rashid Khan is the original singer. So
So here's Vishal.
Is a published Assamese poet, composer and singer. He is an IAS officer who currently works in the capacity of Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India. He will be reading his own poem, Scattered Clouds.
Babanji, are you there? I don't think so. Never mind. Continue the next.
Miss Lippi Parida is a published poet, novelist, flautist and a well-known painter. She will be reading her own poem today.
Good evening, and Dr. Rita, thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my poetry with all of you. The promise of Malhotra's. Monday again, a week to speed across, while the alarm ticks, the heart grows morose, waiting for weakened coffee yet again, with a chocolate heart full of cocoa grain. across the green of the wayside. Sunshine filters through time, softly harping on the grass, with yet another hope of mine. Red roses, smiling with hopefulness. It seems their color paints me, and scarlet colored, I step out into the world unhesitatingly. Sunshine hearts float out to the warmth of the sky. Only my mug holds the promise of undelivered cries. Held in the sky, the glow of the sun, the promise of Amaltas against frozen skies, the color of smoke, perchance I might spy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Robinson Robert is a theologian and a curator of art and heritage works. He'll be reading his own poem, Flags.
Oh, thank you, all you beautiful souls who are here celebrating poetry. And I like to believe poetry is a goddess. This is a poem called Flags, dedicated to Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., civil rights activist, true Gandhian, and some of us trying to follow in the same footsteps, though it is getting difficult every passing day. Flags. How I wish there were no flags in this world. It is these flags that have divided us on the basis of caste, color, creed, and religion. Every time a flag was created, it drew a line on the human heart and divided us further. How I wish there were no flags in this world. It took a swastika for Hitler to create a whole Holocaust. It took pin flags to divide the country that I belong to into India and Pakistan, the vacuum of which still has not been filled in many a heart. How I wish there were no flags in this world, and we'll all cohabit Mother Earth under the umbrella of one true flag, the beautiful sky, for all times to come. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Nivedita Sen is a poet-painter who has had several solo exhibitions of her art in India and abroad. She'll be reading her own poem, Rain.
Good evening, everybody here. This is called Rain. Rain. That was rain. Rain arrived, searching me out, when my sky blackened and I stood dark against the wall, when somewhere in the galactic route a star fell asleep halfway on its routine course. And just when I thought this is what an unending night is, the sky opened up and it rained. And whenever an eternal desert spreads out around us and inside our bodies and souls, when only a few last leaves hang loosely on our parched arms, just when I rise to go away into the other room, somewhere in a distant land, you whisper my name and the sky opens up. It rains. It rains when I am full, up to the brim, when words lock me out, and my colors freeze, my canvases grow numb, when shadows crowd around the corners of a synthetic sleep, when my kitchen grows boring with mundane noise, utensils and spices lose their rhythm, when sweet is no more succulent, doors and windows open up to the heavy, dark clouds, and it rains. Thank you.
She is an educator and a homemaker. She will be reading Spaces of Hope by Ivan Lee Ballard.
And I am the smallest fish in the whole this elite society, and I'm really honored to be part of it, and I'm happy. And really very, very happy to be here. The Spaces of Hope is the poem which I'm going to read, and it's been written by Frances R. Jones. I have experienced the spaces of hope, the spaces of moderate mercy, experienced the places which suddenly set into the random form. A lilac garden, a street in Florence, a morning room, a sea smeared with silver before the storm, or a starless night lit only by a book on the table. The spaces of hope are in time not linked into a system of miracles, nor into a unity. They merely exist, as in Canfinar, at the station, wind in the wild vine, the quarter century ago, one piece of hope, another set somewhere in the future, is already destroying the void around it, unclear but real, probable. In the spaces of hope, light grows, free of charge, and voices are clearer. Death has a beautiful shadow. The lilac blooms later, but for that it looks like its first ever flower. Thank you.
पुनः मैं आपके सामने हूँ और पुनः मैं धन्यवाद करता हूँ सर के एम्बेसी और मैडम का जिन्होंने मुझे बुलाया. अभी जगमोहन जी आप सबके सामने आए थे एक कविता पढ़ने के लिए. बहुत प्यारे इंसान हैं, मेरा उनसे बहुत घनिष्ठ रिश्ता है और मैं उनकी गजलों को गाता हूँ और बहुत फख्र से गाता हूँ, बहुत मजे से मोहब्बत से गाता हूँ. तो एक बहुत ही प्यारी गजल, प्यारे उसमें बहुत उसमें शेर हैं जो आपको अच्छे लगेंगे, आप ध्यान से सुनिएगा.
चल रहा है, चल
Gratitude to His Excellency, Ambassador of the Republic of Serbia, Ambassador Maric, for his encouragement and support for this humble effort by Poetry Scratches to bring the poetic sensibilities of the two countries on a common platform. We are also deeply grateful to Ambassador Dr. Ambarodri Khotia for taking time out of his busy schedule and addressing this event. I take this opportunity for thanking Dr. H.K. Kaul for agreeing to be our guest of honor today. Deep thanks are due to Mr. Dusan Vukic for his cooperation in coordinating this event. And may I add that this evening would have been incomplete without renditions in Serbian language by Mrs. Maric. PSC is deeply grateful to Professor Ashok Malhotra for all the pains that he took for this event. The vote of thanks would also be incomplete without mentioning how this event is the outcome of the poetic dedication and vision of Dr. Rita Malhotra of bringing together nations and cultures through poetry and her tireless effort in this direction. The event wouldn't have been possible without poetic renditions by eminent poets and enthusiastic participation by budding poets. Special thanks to the artists Dr. Gunjan Jha and Mr. Vishal Bhattacharya for the spellbinding performances. I would also extend heartfelt thanks to the volunteers and team members who made this program possible through their sincere efforts. Thank you to the supporting staff. And last but not the least, I'm thankful to you all for being a wonderful audience today. Thank you. I request all of you to join us for light refreshments. Thank you, everybody. And